The stock praise for most contemporary art is to praise it for subverting its genre or form. I don't think it even means anything anymore. It's just a stand-in for saying something is good. I know it means nothing because people said this about Breaking Bad, and it's perhaps one of the most true-to-form works in all of recent history. Breaking Bad never reinvented the wheel. Vince Gilligan did not seek to change TV forever. He wanted to make a very straightforward TV drama, and he succeeded. But I think that's what makes this show special. Breaking Bad is probably the last broadly acclaimed and watched show that just means to be a show and nothing more. It is absent of politics, genre bending too clever by halfness, or any of the things that mark TV and film from 2014 on. This is and has been one of the most digestible shows ever made. Its total mastery of the modern science of TV writing production, which is what makes it so strange in the context of today. I figured it as a sign that the code on TV had been cracked, as the veteran X-Files writer Gilligan had figured out what hooks viewers, what works, and what doesn't. And that most TV shows in the future would be at least as watchable, and it would be the norm for things to go on as long and be as culturally penetrative as Breaking Bad was. This obviously did not happen. We intend to talk a lot about Breaking Bad, the cultural institution, and how it's one of the last of its kind. But to first understand that, we must talk about Breaking Bad, the show. So, watching it again. No, nothing really groundbreaking that I noticed too much. Breaking Bad, when you watch it, you can see it as a continuation of shows like The Rockford Files or The X-Files or something like that. Or, what was that show with Pierce Brosnan?
Remington Steele.
Yeah. And that is to say, it was like a very straightforward TV product that has like a bit of a hook, but isn't trying to, you know, as we said, reinvent the wheel.
The only difference is that it takes that approach to kind of a pure genre, but it applies it to the season and the series long arc as opposed to the discrete episodes.
Yeah. This show like didn't really lend itself to episode arcs, yeah. Which is what I think is interesting about it. It's in its form and in its competence, it's a lot like Law and Order or something like that, mm-hmm. But it's not really episode. You can't really do an episodic show for Breaking Bad.
And I think that's because like this is an attempt to genrefy fully, like synthesize the prestige tropes into a genre form so that you now have a show that in all respects you engage with as one of these prestige programs that is supposed to be a higher brow, but is in point of fact genre, what is digestible, what's indigestible. And one of the things I think that's indigestible is it's got to be serialized. If you are doing episode by episode arcs, you will not be taken seriously. You are a network cable show for old people. That's just the way it is. You will not be talked about in the salons of the online recapping community.
Yeah. And I actually consider it's harder to make good episodic TV, in my opinion.
Absolutely it is. You get to be so flabby with characterization and stuff because you just know the audience is going to give you so much rope to hang yourself with and so much time to sketch things out and allow you to be so indulgent, especially if the show becomes popular. Whereas you have to economize your storytelling if you're telling an individual story. And that is a challenge. And you know, in a genre where it's collaborative and it's commercialized, a challenge like that can make things more interesting and more compelling than just watching another flabby, fake suspenseful show like the spinoff show of Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul, which is just takes all of the elements of Breaking Bad and just decides to concentrate them and condense them like a demi-glace.
Yeah. Thinking about episodic shows, I think about Gunsmoke a lot. And what I really think about is Justified.
Mm, yes, exactly.
And
a show you could see people when it came out talking about it, being like, it's good and it's got good dialogue, but and the character, but you know, they did a one story thing. You could see the people like rejecting like a donor kidney because the fucking blood, the blood type doesn't match.
Yeah, exactly. And if you actually break it down, if you actually make someone explain it, what makes Justified more frivolous than Breaking Bad?
Nothing.
They're both equally ridiculous. The idea of, like, I mean, I would actually say Justified is less ridiculous.
Because it's so self-aware in many ways of its own, like, myth-making. Like, Raylan Givens is much more self-conscious about play acting as a archetype, lawman.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, there's something that's supposed to be sort of Shakespearean about Walt's, like, transition over time.
Yes, exactly. Like, Justified, the one thing they kind of give you with this character is like, okay, he's really good at quick drawing a semi-automatic pistol, but he sucks at everything else. And just at being good at quick drawing is stupid. Like, it doesn't help him at his
That's not a 21st century skill.
Yeah. So it like, and it's not, again, Justified isn't a genre bender, but every single episode, they write these really good, really engaging and fun episode arcs. With, like, the villain of the week. They do a great job with creating unique, entertaining, but not, like, completely takes you out of it ridiculous villains. And Breaking Bad, like, I still really love Breaking Bad, but if you want to break it down, like, okay, a terminally ill science teacher just outsmarts every cartel in the world. That's more ridiculous.
It turns out that he is the greatest genius to have ever lived.
Yeah. And it's like, in the end of the day, like, who gives a shit? It's TV. It's supposed to be ridiculous.
Yeah, right.
But it makes me think of all the caveats that people offered when they would talk about how good Justified was. And that's the key word. It was good. Breaking Bad is great, even though in believability and adherence to genre, they're exactly the same, with Breaking Bad even being a little bit more ridiculous.
Yeah. It's just more, I mean, it has more pretensions of quality. That's the difference. Serialized, and instead of an archetype, the main character is this supposedly, like, changing character, because Raylan Givens doesn't really change.
No.
And Walt is supposed to be this change character. And that illusion of growth is where that's where your prestige value add, and that's the difference between being considered, like, one of these, you know, defining shows and being an FX also-ran. Even though in reality, FX shows, by virtue of being aware of their limitations, often have more staying power.
Yeah, if I was making a show, I would rather work with FX than anyone.
Yeah, I would want to be, like, fully aware of what it means to make a fucking television show.
Yeah, they seem completely aware. That puts them so far ahead of every other asshole that makes TV.
Yeah.
But I do think that's interesting, the central question of whether Walt changes his character or if he's the same guy throughout. Because that is maybe the one thing I grew a different opinion on watching it the second time around. Maybe I'm being a little bit too generous, but I don't think the idea was that Walt changes. I think it's sort of a self-actualization. But, like, from the moment we see him, Walt's kind of an asshole. Like, he has the opportunity to never have to do any of this, but he doesn't because of his pride.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's the thing, is that, I mean, you could say that that's the cleverness. It's not really him changing, it's him revealing himself. But at the same time, that means that it gives you an excuse for him to always be, like, making decisions from the point of view of the most, of the crime kingpin of Heisenberg.
Yeah, and it is a tad ridiculous, because even if this guy was always a dick and always very ambitious and always very smart, well, if you're still, like, a lame dad and science teacher for 20 years, you can't just immediately jump into drug dealing and be better than everyone.
Like, I'm just going to suddenly become better than everyone. And honestly, I feel like that's one of the things about the show that was very relatable. And I think a reason that it was such a big hit and it became one of the defining shows of the era is because, you know, as the AJ Sopranos started leaving the nest and getting, you know, unfulfilling office jobs or wasting time on, or not getting jobs, either way, wasting time talking about shows on the internet. There started to be this, like, sense of being thwarted, with the assumption being that everyone you know, all of these people who've gone to school and learned stuff and like convinced themselves, everyone thinks that if they were just able to like focus, they'd be able to become the greatest genius at whatever they want to do. And so Walter is sort of their self-image. I mean, there's a reason that Heisenberg became such a favorite avatar on Twitter.
Yeah, and it sort of works both ways. To draw it all the way through, you know, this disaffected college graduate would be able to use his critical thinking college skills to beat everyone at crime, as if no one in crime has any ability to think abstractly.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
But
and it's like people said, oh, that's racist. Like, he's saying he's better than Mexicans at it. First of all, I think it's more racist to assume that cooking meth is some like Latino folk way.
Yeah.
He's culturally appropriating. Yeah, that's a great point. There have been fucking bikers making meth out there for 40 years. Like white trash guys, they would already have their own perfectly perfected mechanism. You're not going to come in there and reinvent the wheel.
Yeah. You know who's amazing at crime? Are people from Naples and Russians and other classically white people, or not so classically white people. Recently, in the past 120 years, white people, but you get my point.
Yeah, right.
But to draw that full circle, it's like, yeah, you would get a foothold in crime, but then your revenge on the white collar world that still cucks you is that you've brought this this street savagery and low cunning, like as exemplified when, you know, Walt gets one over on Lydia, or Walt convinces his former associates to launder his money for Walt Jr. at the end by just having two imbeciles with laser pointers bamboozle them. Just
like, hey, this is basically Bill and Melinda Gates. Like, they don't have their own security detail. They don't have their own anything. Nope. Just these two meth heads put a fucking flashlight on them, and they say, we swear legally to give your family this money.
Yeah. Like, just so, like, those, like, people like that, like, someone with the wealth of, like, Les Wexner wouldn't immediately track down every one of their family members and associates and put a gun in their mouth. Be like, I'm going to do what for you now? I mean, to flip a famous line from the show around on its head, you know who's the danger? Bill and Melinda Gates. They're way scarier than a Walter White.
Terrifying.
No, yeah, they're doing eugenics in sub-Saharan Africa and getting good press for it somehow. That is way scarier than Heisenberg. But that is, I think, the weakness of it is that it's wish fulfillment. But I think that's another thing that you can't escape if you're making TV. Because all TV now, like, even as good and as competent as Gilligan and the entire crew and the actors are, like, it is one of the best casts of any of these types of shows. The point of TV, a long-running TV show, is that you're making identity politics for whoever watches it. And Breaking Bad is identity politics for, like,
absolutely,
like, white guys. And
yep,
like, even though the most emblematic character of its viewer base is Gale,
yeah,
they all get to think, no, I'd be Walter.
Yep. It's like they're all Gale, but they think they're Walter. Absolutely.
Yeah, that, I mean, but that's the game in making TV. For the past like 15 years, every show is for a type of person. Gilmore Girls is for, like, a type of, like, liberal late 20s woman. You know, fucking Friday Night Lights is for, like, younger, weepier, younger millennials. Everything is made. Yeah, okay. So the thing I said about Breaking Bad being an example of the state of the art of TV writing, I think I've mischaracterized it, because there is a science of TV writing that people uniquely understand. It's not to make shows good. Like this, like, if every show was as good as this, great, fine, fuck it, whatever. I wish every show was as well made and digestible as Breaking Bad. But where the science and technology comes in is figuring out how to appeal to the part of people's brains where they want to see themselves reflected in the show. Figuring out how to do that as efficiently as possible. That's where all the development goes to now.
Yep. Getting that, like, reflection, reflecting that character to you. And you got, like, there's the difference between a character like Tony Soprano, who is you're meant to identify with in a way that sparks discomfort.
Yes.
But with Walt, it's soothing. It's especially when you see the Walt's character arc and what happens and how he is never irredeemable and in fact is able to redeem himself.
Yeah, he wins. Well,
of course, because that's the audience. Like you can't they want that too. They imagine that too, and so the show flatters them in that.
I think Breaking Bad as a cultural institution is undetachable from a type of like Reddit or Something Awful guy, the guy with the same like fucking square black glasses that every guy who ever worked with computers in your office had, the same like affect, the same taste in pretty much everything. It's undetachable from that type of person. Even if that isn't its entire fan base, tons of women loved and watched the show. But when I think of it as a lasting cultural institution, that's who I think of.
Absolutely. Yeah, he gave a bunch of people a vision of themselves,
mm-hmm.
and like a visual language and metaphors to like process their own frustration.
You said something interesting earlier that I want to sort of touch back on, where you talked about how Breaking Bad was sort of a mark of efficiency in the process of taking all these elements that people will tell people's brains that they're watching Prestige and putting them in, if it's even not as high a form of art as like Deadwood or Sopranos. What do you think some of those were?
One of the big ones is just the cinematography. Yes. And the cinematic look. Like the Sopranos is not a very cinematic show. It really does look like a TV show. Yes. For most of its run. It gets more cinematic in the later seasons, but especially, I mean, even the first half of that run, it is a TV show. Now, Deadwood, you know, had very sumptuous, wonderful sets.
Yeah.
But it was very cramped in interior. Breaking Bad has these just giant vistas and the big wide lenses, and it uses cinematic tropes just in narrative form, and it just feels like a movie. It's like, it is like our idea of a Paul Thomas Anderson, Coen Brothers, Tarantino tier of like middle brow like genre auteurs.
Yeah.
And we get to watch that. And I think that's doing a lot of the work.
Yeah, it's middle brow is the best way to describe the show, because there are tons of shots that are very good shots, but if the middle brow audience sees them and identifies them, they're like, oh, I'm the only one who noticed what a great shot that
is. That's the point of it. That's the point of it, to be like, spot the reference so you can point it out in the comments section.
It is the cinematic equivalent of the Something Awful goon telling you that there's an arrow in the FedEx logo that only they've noticed before.
Yep.
Yeah. That's the thing, though. It's like, we are making all these notes of it, but it is still like, I will probably be able to rewatch the show for the rest of my life. It's still an incredibly easy to watch show. It's a very good show.
Yeah, it goes down smooth.
And something I do think is interesting with it is this incredibly lasting thing, but it is so weirdly apolitical for the time it was made in.
That is, it's astounding to think of how it was able to get away from that. How it was able to get away, because I remember there was always some, at the end of the show's run, there was chirping about the show being white racist because of Walt appropriating, you know, native Latino drug built yeah. cooking culture, and misogynist because of the treatment of Skyler. But that was not self-consciously in the show itself, really. Like it did feel like it was operating outside of this context of like constantly like course correcting according to a meta conversation about the show itself.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think Gilligan's intention or the network's intention was necessarily like, here you go, like Redditors, here's all your resentments and all your wish fulfillment. I mean, I think they knew enough of what they were doing as far as like, okay, like a certain type of college graduate is really going to fucking like this show, but it wasn't like, you know, they were doing some Cambridge Analytica shit. Which,
No, I mean, it's just it's the like the moments like create these markets and these metaphorical languages to express this like nest of experiences, and certain people are going to come together and like through echolocation find an expression of that in the marketplace of ideas.
Exactly. And I think any of those criticisms that people had later on, and especially towards the end, as you noted, those are, first of all, only like you are not criticizing Breaking Bad. You're criticizing TV as a format.
Right.
You know, like, yeah, no, there's going to be a character that has to appear as a wet blanket. There is going to be a degree of absurd wish fulfillment for whoever is the main demographic that watches the show.
Exactly. Like, that's the part when people get mad about that. It's like, oh, yeah, this is where you've mistaken what you're talking about. This is a TV show. I know we have these ideas about them, but there's realities of this. Like, there's entropic principles at play within the making of a television show, and you shouldn't really be expecting this. And it's kind of it's not really like good faith artistic interpretation, honestly, to expect that.
Yeah.
You've been tricked to think that.
And it's absurd. When you actually break it down, it's absurd, because if you remember these like 2012, 2013 essays in the Cultural Digest of Record, they're like, listen, I love Breaking Bad, but it's Nazi propaganda. Like, okay, do you love it? Or do you think it should be? Because if you actually think that, it should. You're saying it shouldn't exist.
Yeah, like, what the hell, man? I mean, does this stuff matter or not? If it doesn't, then why are you bringing it up?
Yeah, it's like, listen, I love this show, but it's going to make men kill all women because Skyler is annoying.
Yeah.
Like, okay, what is
Let's say, no, those, hey, sometimes you got to break an omelet. You know, you got to break some eggs.
Yeah.
My entertainment is worth that.
It's one of those criticisms that says more about the person saying it than it does the show. Yes. Way more.
Yes, absolutely.
But, it almost feels like this oasis of a massive cultural product, a massive institution, like something that people still talk about endlessly, that you can, if you go on any part of Reddit, you can see an unfunny meme about it still today, anywhere on Reddit. Mm-hmm. I don't know what's on Reddit, but, you know, r/childfree, you'll see something on there.
Yes.
But, it's not really as like gif-able there aren't as many politics, and people don't even make politics analogies with it. You know,
it never got that like that Game of Thrones treatment.
Yeah, it's so weird to compare to Game of Thrones, because I think the fan base probably overlaps a great deal.
I watched both.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think about all the people I know who are really into this show. They're also incredibly into Game of Thrones. But Game of Thrones, which takes place in like a patched together, you know, medieval England with magic.
Yeah.
People cannot stop saying that Nancy Pelosi is fucking whoever on that show. And this show that takes place in the modern world with very modern problems, just nothing. Nothing. And I do wonder. And it's not like this is a product of its time necessarily, because other shows that were around this time still have – there's an incredible political element to it, to all of it, to all of it. I mean, Mad Men is that way. Even – I would argue The Sopranos is explicitly more political, even though I don't consider it political in the same way that a lot of these other shows are. And I do wonder how Gilligan was able to get away with that.
Yeah, I think people were just looking for that, because that's the one thing we hadn't really seen, was that fully genre-sized prestige show where it's just pure sugar.
Yes.
And I think everyone was just on a sugar high and they didn't really care.
Yeah.
Like they didn't need to throw politics into it, because they were getting their jollies elsewhere just from the pure aesthetics of it.
Yeah, and it's also it's just as noticeable in the same way that it's a show, a massive cultural institution without any real culture war notes of its own that it wanted to put out there, or no political notes of its own that it wanted to put out there. It's also lacking in any like a creator's sense of irony on the side of the creator, because I feel like, you know, shows like Hannibal or whatever, like shows like network or basic cable shows that are okay for you to watch if you think of yourself as the highest consumer of culture, they're always okay to watch now because it's like, oh, it knows it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a parody of the genre. Yeah. Oh, it's a deconstruction.
Will, are you gay, Will?
yeah.
Will, have you asked yourself, why are you gay?
yeah, no, that's everything after it. If it's as ridiculous, the type of product that Breaking Bad is supposed to be, it's supposed to be self-aware and postmodern. Yeah,
like the fucking Brian Murphy, the Ryan Murphy shows. Yes.
Yeah, like everyone is eating from the same trough. Or, you know, if you want to put it differently, if you've ever been to Wrigley Field in Chicago, they're taking a twisty straw and drinking out of the same piss trough that's in every men's room at that field. But we're all consuming the same monoculture, but you get the piss that's on the far end of the stall, and you're like, no, this is funny because it knows it's piss. No, this is okay. This is not like that piss over there. It's better to watch Hannibal than it is to watch like CSI because Hannibal knows it's Hannibal.
Yeah, no, you got to have otherwise it's cringe.
Yeah.
You can't have any cringe.
Yeah. But this was a very straightforward show in the form of the X-Files, I would say.
Yeah, I mean it would be funny when it would push the boundaries of genre stuff and you could see kind of this immune system kick in within the critical response to it. I know this because at this moment, when that show was on, I was one of those awful people. I was at my most bug man like in my existence, leading the goddamn comment section on like AV Club episodes of truly bleak time.
Of
Breaking Bad.
I read every like Steppenwolf recap, and I can do you one worse than what you did. I didn't post in it. But this is probably worse. I lurked in the Something Awful Breaking Bad thread.
Oh, God. Wow.
That is below bug, man. That's it's like that's, whatever crabs eat, that's what I am.
Yeah, that's an absolute troglodyte. Wow, that's awful.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Yeah, it was fun in this way. I haven't really seen anything like that since on the internet, and I think it's because deep down, even though the whole thing on this space of the internet, thinking that you're better than anyone else, you think you're too good to watch like a straightforward TV show. But when it was actually given to us, people fucking loved it more than anything.
They loved it. They were like, this is what we wanted. We wanted a mirror. We wanted this fun mirror we could look into.
Yeah. I don't, yeah. So I think the best lens to sort of look at like the cultural effect and whether you think the show betrayed its own intentions or not is the lens of the final season.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's when the show had reached its cultural epoch. They made that show at the height of critical acclaim and popular attention. The show started with pretty good ratings. It steadily gained like the first three seasons, but then like The Wire, only on a much higher scale, it just exploded in its last few seasons. And the last season was written and shot in a atmosphere of absolute frenzy. People were getting wet for that show.
Yeah. So, I mean, I have to say, I think just as something to watch, I would probably say like the first few seasons are better because they haven't yet made Walt the smartest man who's ever lived. Like
he wasn't like a Bond villain.
Yeah, exactly. Like he's just like, he's like sort of a pompous guy who uses like mid-tier cunning to outsmart people who aren't like the highest level of drug dealers. Like
that's the thing. It's like he basically won because most of the people he was dealing with are like actual children or complete dullards or completely drug fried or something.
Yeah, it's not a great feather in your cap to outsmart Tuco.
Yeah, exactly. He's not it's not a real battle of wit.
Yeah. But like I those seasons are more fun for me to watch because there's a more understandable basic tension. Whereas I think you can divide the show into two halves in the sense like obviously there's the delineation you used before the massive supernova explosion of popularity in the last three. But I think of it I divide it in these terms. The show when he's hiding his meth business from Skyler and the show after.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I divide it. Because after, it's like this sort of tension and the ability for the character to go back to his old life is gone. It's gone. And you're just going to see him fully realize as a psycho. And
yeah, because the central tension is resolved.
Yeah.
So now he has to get the tension from somewhere else. So that means he has to become a drug kingpin.
Yeah, which is fucking absurd. But I don't know. Like, the one thing that's in my old opinion on this was that it was – they did a bad job wrapping this up. But there is one thing that makes me think differently in the final episode. And people never talk about this when they criticize Breaking Bad, because it's just as sure as it was an institution to be a bug man commenting on every episode and blog post about it, it's also now an institution to talk about how bad it was at the end. But I did really – it's just one scene and it's just one line really. But when he says that he did all this because he was good at it, yeah. I actually did really love that.
That was good. It was a good bit of drama.
Yeah.
Like the character just dropping a facade.
And it's, I mean, I guess you could, if you're being ungenerous to it, you could say it's cheap in the way that like JR's ending or the ending on The Shield is, where it's like, oh no, bad people get their comeuppance, or like bad people do this or become aware of it. But I did like it, because I think there is this measure of like great man worship in everything made in America. Everything. Oh, like, yeah. Even Entourage. Like, even fucking Entourage is like, no, Ari Gold is the best at being an agent. Like, it's the American worship of meritocracy is so fucking sick and deep that even on Entourage, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
But, you know, they could have very well done, like, oh, I needed to do this because, you know, well, they would have paid for my cancer treatment, but what if I died? Like, we'd need money or what? No, it's just like he's an asshole and he liked feeling good at something.
Yeah. But then the thing is that the way it kind of cheaps out is that then he is able to, you know, he admits this horrible truth, this brutal truth. But then that thing about him being good at it, he is able to use it to essentially get the ending that he wanted at that point. Because, like, if he did it because it's fun, but, like, that goal of securing his family's future, he did it. Like, the thing he wanted to do when he started the whole thing, he succeeded at, which is, you know, the opposite of most tragedies where, you know, someone is... in fact, they destroy the thing they were seeking because their pursuit of it is, you know, tainted by selfishness or whatever.
And I guess, I don't know, that last episode.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, it's just fucking absurd in every single way. He makes a machine gun robot.
He makes a robot machine gun. He uses two half-wit meth heads to scare Bill and Melinda Gates into giving him like a future... stipend of hundreds of millions of dollars, and then he defeats the entire Nazi cell in New Mexico.
Yeah, he destroys like Vern Schillinger's upper management.
And saves Jesse.
So okay, that's what I think is actually the most ridiculous thing. If you're Jesse, don't you just fucking kill him?
Yeah,
he's taken everything from you, and
of course
multiple times.
He can't keep getting away with it.
He's ruined your life so many fucking times. And so, like, Walter is directly or indirectly responsible, however you want to look at it, for the deaths of two of the loves of Jesse's life.
Yep. But here's the thing. Because Walt is the viewer, Walt has to be redeemable.
Yeah.
So Walt has to, even if Skyler's still mad at him, she's going to, at the end of the day, forgive him because he got her the money. He secured their future. She doesn't have to work at as a maid anymore. And Jesse, God damn it. I hate, he got these people killed and all that. But you know what? He saved me at the end. So got to tip my cap to him. And it's like, maybe there are some things you do that people can't forgive you for.
Yeah.
And it's just too inconceivable. Like, they talked, like Gilligan talked about how much pressure they felt with the finale. Like, they did not want people to be mad at them.
That, yeah, no. Audience feedback is the worst thing that's ever happened to TV.
Absolute thing. They were totally restricted. Like, that ending was essentially determined for them by their awareness of their audience. Like, Heisenberg literally fucked that show. Like, the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle destroyed their ability to do a fucking final season of that show because they were so hyper aware of viewer expectations that they could not do something like take this character who these people had all deeply psychically identified and tell them in like Tony Soprano fashion that he is irredeemable.
Yeah, no. And you can like you can go the other like Deadwood has sort of I wouldn't really call it a happy ending, but like a happy or somewhat optimistic denouement. Like there is a civilizing principle to community. But again, you can't do that with Breaking Bad. Because the reason the Deadwood only lasted three fucking seasons is because you can't have a TV show that's about how the community is more important than the individual. It's totally antithetical to TV.
So the last line of the show, while Al is cleaning the blood up from this innocent young prostitute who they had to sacrifice to Hearst, like a literal blood sacrifice to Mammon. Like fucking Moloch demanding a fucking, you know, soul so that the system, that this community could be consecrated. And it's Johnny is like very distraught because he liked her. And, you know, he leaves the room and Al says he wanted me to tell him something pretty.
Yeah.
And that's why they got three seasons, because they were not going to tell you something pretty.
No. They were going to say that community is civilizing and it's more important than the individual, but it's still not a happy ending. But yeah, it's the best ending you get.
There's no Superman. Yeah. There's no Ubermensch who like bursts out through like all social constraints like Heisenberg did, who isn't able to like transcend all social forms, obligations, and restrictions. Like Walt could not be stopped. Nothing could stop him. No legal, no moral order, no legal formation. The United States government, nothing could stop him.
Not even cancer, really. Because even to cancer, he's like, no, fuck you. I'm dying on my own terms.
Yep. He didn't die of the cancer. He took a fucking bullet saving Jesse's life.
Yeah.
How could you die happier? And he does die happy, which is all you could ever ask for any character. Because they're all going to die at some point, if you imagine, past the end of the show, you know?
Yeah, Tony Soprano either dies in agony or lives in agony.
Exactly. He dies in agony, it's just a question of when.
Al Swearengen and Seth Bullock, they live in agony. They live in agony, but some sort of optimistic grasping towards the...
Their agony might mean something, is the thing. Like, their pain might be the source of something. Whereas Tony's is just the anguished end of a process that has no future to it,
or no redemption and no desire for redemption, really.
Yes,
like just feeling bad for yourself
because there's no underlying will to change.
And what Breaking Bad does is like it goes in both directions. It goes the Sopranos direction, where it's like, okay, this character was always a bad guy, but we're gonna make you more aware of it. And it goes in the Deadwood direction, where it's like, okay, we're gonna soften this character. But because it's Breaking Bad, because it's like a lower form than both these things, he gets out of that Tony Soprano spiral and attains the Al Swearengen spiral by doing what he always did, thinking he could outsmart everyone. And it's like,
and doing it.
It's like, you know what it's like? It's like Dragon Ball Z. It's like Goku loses a fight and it's like, oh, I'm just going to become more powerful.
Yes, it's like there's no change. There's no humbling, which has to be like conditional for any meaningful like spiritual change. Some like redirection of the self away from the self. Meanwhile, it turns out that for Walt, all he had to do is just be more awesome.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Walt just goes like, oh, wait till I get pissed off.
Yeah,
that's it. It's idiotic. When you
put Jesse in a torture slave cage. Oh boy, you have no idea what's coming. Yeah,
watch out, buddy. And I think about that. I compare it to Seth Bullock. And Seth Bullock is a great character because like that's his weakness. And he knows he's like, oh, I get too pissed and I'm an idiot. Or the same with Raylan Givens, really. Even Raylan, like Raylan Givens is constantly fucking up his own life and the lives of others because he gets too pissed.
Yeah,
it's not a good thing to be like,
yep.
It's like, oh, by taking this individual selfish course of action, I've alienated everyone. I've even like endangered people's lives or outright gotten them killed. Okay, I just have to do it harder. It's like it works for him, and that, I mean, I guess I have to reevaluate this now. I would put it as a lower form than justified. Easily.
Yeah, I think so. It's you gotta just, when you see how much in Breaking Bad is just sort of cynical furniture,
mm-hmm.
it really does make you think, you know what? Give me a confident genre film that isn't trying to sell me on something.
So, wrapping up the discussion of the actual show, what do you think the legacy of the show is culturally?
I think that it set the terms for like the unfolding question of like protagonists, mm-hmm. and like social responsibility, because what Breaking Bad helped create, now it didn't exist in it, but now it does, is a critical space around television where the question of like the virtue of the point of view of the show itself through its main characters becomes the signal question. Like, that's what people are now arguing. Like, that's what criticism of shows is now.
Yeah.
And I think that by being an anti-hero, you know, by being there with, like, especially alongside Don Draper, like the white male anti-hero, that became the thing that people responded to. And now shows are explicitly written to deny that archetype.
Right, right. Or the hero has actually regressed, and it's like the Marvel form where the hero is like a well-meaning white male but can only achieve victory by listening to women. Like, is like, that's like the fucking Lone Ranger. That's what that goes back. Like, that's, but and it's an unfortunate thing to happen to the show, because I think it was less cynically made than a lot of its antecessors. But death of the author.
Yeah.
If there is an economic need for SEO propped up blogs and media outlets to talk about this thing that is popular, there's going to be a demand for takes.
Yep, the takes will flow.
And if all you have is like 200 level, you know, college gender classes or fucking whatever, that's what you're going to get.
Yep.
That's all you're going to get. I think like probably a lot of the modern blogging economy grew out of Breaking Bad blogging.
Oh, 100%. 100%.
If not necessarily the blogs themselves and the outlets themselves, but definitely like the form of it. Of taking this.
And because Breaking Bad was one of those first shows where it wore its narrative on its sleeve in such a way that it gave you little pegs, like we're talking about how it's cinematic. One of the ways it was cinematic is that it used symbolic language. You know, it used mise-en-scene, but in very kind of underlined ways, and that gave people a little thing to talk about. It gave them a little like entrepot to talking about each episode. They really did. It was like how, you know, like milk boxes have the little scoring for you to put back the thing and open it up.
Yeah. Yeah. That said, for how important Breaking Bad is to like a sort of modern liberal internet culture, I think you cannot have one with the other. You cannot have this culture without the community that formed around watching the show and then quickly coming up with very basic gender studies takes on it. I don't think we're going to see another show like this for quite some time. I think the only way you get a show like this that's very straightforward and that almost everyone watches is if there is an economic death spiral for media companies. That's the only way.
Yeah. Yeah, we get back to that like capitalized point where we're like, okay, we got to pack as much audience into a thing as possible.
Yeah, and that's very possible. It's very I mean, you know my opinion on modern media. I feel like it's a house of cards.
Closing time is going to be called shortly, pretty clear.
Yeah.
There's going to be a big, big consolidation and just a huge purge of media jobs.
Yeah.
There are going to be fewer jobs in media.
Yeah. Or, I mean, we've always talked about this as the most ridiculous way this gets solved is if there's an American sovereign wealth fund that, yes. that and anyone can make a show.
I mean, that's honestly our only way is it's like the WP, like a market socialist WPA.
Yeah.
Where we put this stuff out there and we absorb some loss leaders in exchange for maintaining a actual coherent cultural by output, which we need because that is one of the two things the United States exports. That's what circulates the currency. Arms and entertainment and media.
I know which one I'd rather export. I mean, I would love that. I mean, it wouldn't even cost us that much in the budget, but I would love, like, there should be a show that's made by, like, you know, just like a fucking black guy in North Carolina, or there should be a show that's made by, like, you know, the only guy in Terre Haute, Indiana, who has a pierced ear. Or there should be a show just made by, like, a guy who the only part of his day he likes is mowing his lawn on his rider mower. Like, every type of, like, American should make a show. Like, there should be a show that's by
real, like, representation, not, like, having, like, existing structures of pandering, you know, triangulation, absorb another thing to pander to.
Yeah.
Like actual expressions of people's, lives.
That's what I think is so unfortunate about this state of American culture is that I do think one of the things that America has that I really like about it and I like about living here is that I think we generally, probably for bad reasons, but still generally create very interesting, very disparate types of people and types of people who live very active fantasy lives because the main focus and main tasks of their lives are so demeaning and pointless. And just different people you meet here, they run the range from like having awful fucking violent, murderous opinions to maybe personally being very charitable and very open in this strange way. And all live this rich narrative that they've crafted mentally to cope with the pain of their alienated life. And what's unfortunate is our culture does not reflect that at all. Our culture flattens all these types of people into just their gender or their age or how much disposable income they have. And these companies now that make these successors to Breaking Bad put them on a sheet of paper or an Excel spreadsheet and go, this type of person is going to identify with this. Let's make this shitty show that our fucking formula told us we'll make the maximum profit on if we run it for 3 seasons. But then because that's the only point at which we can milk subscriptions or milk ad dollars.
Yeah. Yeah. No one's going to stop subscribing if you get rid of it, and no one's going to come along to subscribe after the third season. So that means no matter what, it's finished.
It's a very sad culture to be flattened because I feel like if we should have this form of life that we live and this completely broken down country that can't do anything, we should at least get some good culture out of it, but we're not.
We're getting garbaggio.
And we have every component part that should be able to produce good culture. Which is interesting people. That's all.
That's every level. At every level. Like the military machine we've created, this world bestriding colossus, is this absolute joke.
Yeah.
The fucking media that we have is just wheezing monstrosity because the lie of capitalism that it is somehow a efficient allocation of resources. Yeah. It is a monstrous bonfire of resources. It destroys at every level and places where cooperation could like facilitate actual like fruitful application of resources to questions, like the cultural and material production. Nope, we're making terrible dog shit art that nobody actually likes and that isn't even designed for American audiences at this point. And a bunch of fucking bombs that either sit in a warehouse or blow up some fucking wedding, and then $500 trillion pilot killing machines.
Yeah, we make the world's most expensive battleships that just get lost and hit a rock somewhere in the South China Sea.
And fighter jets that melt in the rain.
There is the only thing that deflated my estimation of Capital's intelligence and cunning more than 08 has been working in media.
Oh yeah.
Media outside of military contracting or something like that, media is where you see the absolute dumbest fucking people in the world command just absurd amounts of liquid assets. Absurd.
Real dummy.
You should see some of the offices of some of the media companies I've written for that I could verify had no readers.
Yes.
But we're spending millions of dollars a year on office space they didn't need. Some of the projects that I've seen these companies embark on, it's idiotic. And again, it's very sad because it just further obscures the actual interesting stories and perspectives you could get out of this country. But hey, that's how she goes, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the tidal gravity just pulling everything apart.
But yeah, I think we are due for a grand media contraction and maybe some sort of economic death spiral for it. But until then, I don't see another show like this being made.
No, we're not. Yeah. It's narrow casting and algorithmic pandering from here on out.
Yeah, no.
Like, we already know that the era of the showrunner, which Vince Gilligan was the apogee of, is over.
No, yeah.
You know, these guys aren't even doing new shows. Like, when was the last time Vince Gilligan had a show?
Yeah. The last...
I mean, I guess, like, the closest thing to it is Better Call Saul.
Yeah.
Like, it is. But even it is now niched in a way that Breaking Bad wasn't.
No, yeah.
It's like a condensed version of Breaking Bad.
I think Better Call Saul is actually a better show, but again, it's not a cultural force in the least.
Yeah, it seems like it's a... It seems like it's the closest thing in terms of a show that when it's on, people reference, but it does not have anything like the staying power of Breaking Bad.
Yeah. I mean, I do feel like we are sort of judging culture in a vacuum for the last 4 years, because everyone who I see talk about politics now, they are people who would have, you know, been on the comments section of Breaking Bad blogs. So maybe that goes back to how it was now and we get a different cultural refractory period, but it is hard to see a way out right now.
Yeah.
That's about all we have to say about Breaking Bad, though, I think.
Yeah. It was pretty epic when he did the thing.
What if Heisenberg fucking killed Justin Bieber? So awesome.
He could blow him up with, he could just make a bomb out of sweat sock and just kill his ass.
Yeah. They're like, hey, Heisenberg, have you heard about Justin Bieber? I've never heard of her. Awesome.
Ah, awesome. You're goddamn right.
Awesome. Say my name. Cool. As always, I'm Felix Biederman.
Matt Chrisman.
We'll see you next time on the shows.
Bye.
All right.
La ciudad se llama Duke, Nuevo México el estado. Entre la gente mafiosa su fama se ha propagado, causa de una nueva droga que los gringos han creado. Dicen que es color azul y que es pura calidad. Esa droga poderosa que circula en la ciudad y los dueños de la plaza no la pudieron parar.